Welcome to Module 6 of the Partner Practice Enablement Bootcamp for Windows Azure. Today's topic will explore how Windows Azure can be used to run dev and test workloads. We will see how the economics of running this workload in the cloud can be realized through a combination of various subscription benefits and automation using PowerShell. Our instructor today will be Rick Rainey. Rick is the co-founder of Opsgility, an organization focused on Windows Azure training. Rick is also a Microsoft veteran. He has a wide range of experience across Windows Azure that we are pleased to bring to you through this training. Please welcome our instructor, Rick.
Thank you very much for that introduction. In this module, we're going to be covering development and test workloads in Windows Azure. We're going to start with an introduction to some common challenges that IT faces in an organization. And then we're going to transition into how Windows Azure can be used to run dev test workloads such that IT is not compromising existing production infrastructures. We're going to take a look at the economics of using MSDN subscription benefits with your Windows Azure subscription and how you can really cut into the costs traditionally associated with supporting dev test environments. And then in the last topic, we'll see some various ways you can get started with virtual machines and networks to support dev test workloads in Azure. So let's just for a minute level set and frame up some context. So cloud computing is bringing forth some really powerful solutions to support various business operations of an enterprise. At the same time, it's also exacerbating some of the common challenges that IT faces for an on-premise environment, in particular around supporting things like dev test workloads, which, by the way, is one of the top workloads running in the cloud today across all cloud providers. You know, for example, integration with applications, services, on-premise environments, and even with third-party applications and services is common in the enterprise today. The security of the environment is front and center. The potential effects of a non-secure environment bringing onto the business can be disastrous. This notion of heterogeneous environments is also very common. Perhaps you have Windows and Linux machines that make up your infrastructure footprint and support for various line of business applications in the organization. And the applications being managed span from things like, say, a CRM system, SharePoint, databases of all flavors. You get the idea. It's not just a single vendor environment. So great, it's complex and there's some real challenges to deal with. So the question is, how does IT deal with these challenges and support critical operations for the business, such as dev test workloads? So Microsoft's approach to this is from two different perspectives. One from an application owner's perspective and another from the IT administrator's perspective. From the application owner's perspective, at the top of the list is the need to rapidly self-provision an environment for development and testing that is completely independent of a production environment. This enables the development teams to experiment with new technologies and innovate in ways that they could never do before and do so without worrying about impacting critical production applications. Or maybe it's the need to perform some scalability and load testing to ensure an application will be able to handle the load once put into production, another increasingly popular workload for the cloud. From the IT administrator's perspective, maintaining production level SLAs, for example, for applications and services is likely first and foremost. At the same time, the need to provide the resources for application development in a way that budgets for hardware and licensing for software are kept in check, that's also critical to meeting the evolving needs of the organization. So Windows Azure offers solutions to these challenges and meets the needs in a way that is favorable from both perspectives. By using Windows Azure for dev test workloads, application owners are able to self-provision the environments that they need. And because the environment is one that they're deeply familiar with, they can also leverage existing tools and skills. For the administrators, the ability to maintain production SLAs for the enterprise, while at the same time being able to set up and/or manage environments in Azure, is achievable in a way that is for them, centralized, it's secure, and it's cost-effective for the organization. And keeping these environments isolated from production environments is a highly attractive solution for dev test. With Windows Azure, application owners and IT administrators seize this idea of sandboxed environments to support all kinds of operations. It could be a dev environment for experimentation and trying out new ideas, or it might be a formal dev test environment for the next version of an application. It could be QA or staged environment for user acceptance testing. Or it might even just be simply you want to spin up an environment to test a third-party application being considered for the organization. The point here is that environments, or these sandbox environments, if you will, they can be created and destroyed as needed to meet the needs of the business. And because you're paying for what you use, you're really able to do this in a way that's highly cost-effective for the organization. Application owners are able to securely connect to the machines in their environments through a VPN connection, and they can automate the environment using PowerShell if they wish. And in fact, IT can also use PowerShell to automate the creation of the environment and ultimately, you know, the tearing down of the environment, and also the availability of the machines in those environments. We'll see some examples of this later on in the module. So Windows Azure gives you this platform for creating a scalable on-demand infrastructure in the cloud. And whether your scenario is simply testing a new service pack for SharePoint or testing out some new technology to something even more complex as new application features or even a new application entirely, this ability to provision and destroy these environments on demand as needed in a cost-effective way is, in my opinion, one of the reasons this is the number one workload in the cloud today. And while these environments exist in the cloud, using traditional on-premises tools such as System Center, for example, or scripting languages like PowerShell make this a familiar environment for IT to manage. So collectively, when you consider Windows Azure, a platform that provides scalable on-demand infrastructure and MSDN subscriptions through which licensing and hardware costs can be drastically reduced, plus the ability to leverage existing tools and skills through Visual Studio, the dev test workload in Azure is really compelling. So I want to talk just a minute about testing at scale. You know, there's different kinds of testing that you might want to perform. And so just to give you some ideas of how you might approach this, unit and regression testing. So this is a situation whereby your application development team is needing to test the scale of something like a web service, or maybe it's a particular use case for a web app, or maybe it's just a set of internal APIs that they're developing. You know, these kinds of tests, they can also be automated as part of an overall build and development process so that as changes are checked in, these tests are performed, or it could be something that they kick off manually. When it comes to load testing, this could range from testing the application's ability to scale on demand, or maybe it's just simply to find the tipping point for an application so that you better understand its capacity. Perhaps you're looking to do some A/B testing for a small set of production customers, or potentially security testing where you just want to spin up an environment and do some vulnerability scans or do some penetration testing against it. You know, these are some of the things that you can do from a testing perspective. One thing I found is that it's really difficult to talk about dev tests and not slip into a broader DevOps discussion. It is the scope of this module to focus on dev test as a workload that is ideal to run in Azure. And here we're focusing on an application owner's need to self-provision environments for development or an environment that mirrors production for QA. The reality, though, is that there is a very significant operational aspect to this as well. You can talk about creating and destroying environments all you want, but to automate these actions such that the business can respond to market demands as needed is, in my opinion, a bigger story. The reason I put this slide in is simply because I've seen overlap between discussions talking about dev test and discussions talking about DevOps. Naturally, since the two topics in today's module intersect into the broader DevOps story, I just wanted to point this out. So anyway, these terms, dev test and DevOps, you know, they mean different things to different people. And hopefully this helps to highlight how they intersect with one another in the broader story. Now that you've got a good idea of how Windows Azure can be used for dev test workloads, let's take a look for a minute at the economics of this. Through an MSDN subscription, you have access to software and tools to support your development and test operations. This includes a Windows Azure subscription with some levels of credits, which I'll get to shortly. And that also includes access to a Visual Studio 2013 virtual machine image in Azure that you can spin up in just a matter of minutes. You also get access to Visual Studio Online, where your development team can set up continuous integration. They can track code churn, log work items, and schedule and run scalability and load testing using the load testing service. You have the option now to purchase a dev test pay-as-you-go subscription. And through this subscription, multiple team members, you know, a dev team, for example, can share and collaborate on this same subscription. And through this subscription, you get monthly credits that can be used however you want. So, for example, if you were to purchase a professional subscription, then you get $50 a month. For Ultimate, you'd get $150 a month that you can use for any Azure services. It can be virtual machines, it could be, you know, for storage, websites, whatever you wish. With the software you have access to, you can also get cloud usage rights for things like Visual Studio and SharePoint and BizTalk and SQL Server. And again, you pay only for what you're using. So if you just use these for an hour and then tear down the environment, that's all you're paying for. These MSDN dev test rates are significantly less than, say, a traditional standard Azure subscription rate. And while there are some deep discounts in rates at, for example, the OS level, as you can see here, the real benefit comes when you need to test against particular server applications like SQL Server or BizTalk, where you're able to get development and test against these platforms at savings that are well above 90% of standard rates. To create a similar environment otherwise, you know, would cost thousands of dollars. And with MSDN test benefits and the MSDN rates, you can spin up these environments as you need them and do your development or testing at a fraction of that cost. These are just some examples of things you could do with your monthly benefit. Consider, for example, a premium subscription with a $100 a month credit. This would give you three virtual machines for 16 hours a day. Or maybe you just want to do some load testing. So in this case, you could spin up 80 virtual machines for a 20-hour load test. Or you could even run, say, up to 500 websites with a SQL database. How the credit is used is entirely up to you. And it's something else to note here is that when you purchase your MSDN subscription, it is pre-configured with a spending cap. So what that means is that you're never going to incur any charges on that subscription. Once you use your monthly credit, any virtual machines you have running will be shut down once that credit has been used up. None of your data is lost. You just won't be able to access your data, run any services until the next month when your credit is reset. Now, you have the option of lifting the spending cap so that you don't have any interruption of service. You just need to add your credit card information, remove the spending cap, and you'll be automatically charged for anything above your allowed monthly credit. So in this last section, I'm going to talk about ways to get started using Azure to support dev test workloads. And we're also going to see a few demos along the way. The quickest and easiest way to get started is through the Windows Azure Management Portal. As you've seen in the previous modules, from here you can create virtual networks, you can create virtual machines and other services in Azure. And with a dev test MSDN subscription, when you are creating a virtual machine, you'll see an MSDN option at the bottom. This is what gives you access to the Visual Studio image I mentioned earlier. Of course, you get other images as well, but this Visual Studio image is a unique benefit to MSDN subscribers. And this image not only includes Visual Studio 2013, but also an installation of SharePoint, SQL Server, it's got the Azure SDK, and it's even got some configuration scripts to get you set up quickly. So let's take a look at creating a developer machine using the Visual Studio image from the gallery. In this demonstration, I'm going to show you how to create a developer machine using the Visual Studio 2013 image from the gallery. To get started, I'm logged into my Windows Azure Management portal, and I'm currently showing the virtual machines that I've already got configured. So I'm going to create a new one. So I'm going to go down to New, Virtual Machine, and I'm going to select the From Gallery option. What this gives me is an opportunity to select from a number of different images to build my virtual machine from. I can choose server platform images from, say, server 2008 to server 2012, as well as different editions of those versions. I've got a number of products that are have pre-configured images of SharePoint or SQL Server, BizTalk, and even Visual Studio, which is what I'm going to be using here in just a minute. There's also some non-Windows platforms, so if you need to create a Linux machine, you can do that, as well as some predefined images configured with Oracle. Now, one thing I want to point out is the option down here for MSDN. So I mentioned earlier about MSDN subscriptions with DevTest. Through an MSDN subscription, you have this Visual Studio 2013 SKU that's available to you to build your virtual machine from. And that's something that is unique to MSDN subscribers. Not every Azure subscription has this. So I'm going to go ahead and actually go back to that. And I'm going to create a image using the Visual Studio 2013 Ultimate. And what you'll see over in the description for this is going to come complete with not just Visual Studio 2013, but it also includes an edition of SharePoint 2013. It has a developer edition of SQL Server 2012. It also includes the Windows Azure SDK for .NET 2.2, as well as some configuration scripts to get my environment set up quickly. So I'm going to give this machine a name, and just this can be anything I want. I'm going to call this Dev02. These are the recommended settings, is a large for this image. But I could certainly go smaller or larger if I wanted to. I'm just going to take the default, and I'll give this a username and password. This username and password is what you'll use to log into the machine. Next, I'm going to be given the option to create a new cloud service. For this one, I just want the one machine, so I would select that. If instead I was creating, say, a farm of virtual machines for, say, a web server farm, then I would create a new cloud service for the first machine and then add additional virtual machines to that existing cloud service. The cloud service name is just deriving that from the name I gave it, and it has checked the DNS to ensure that it's globally unique. I can put this into a existing virtual network if I like, and I think I'll go ahead and do that. And it's going to go in this subnet. And the next question is, down here in storage account, is where do you want the image for the machine to be stored? What storage account? I'm just going to have the one instance, so I don't really care about the availability set at this point. Next are just the default endpoints that you get with any virtual machine. That's the remote desktop and PowerShell endpoints. I'm going to leave those there for now and click Create. So as you can see, it's starting to provision the virtual machine. And this is going to take a few minutes. So what I've done is pre-configured one, this PPE Dev01. So what I'm going to do is, while we wait for that guy to get created, I'm just going to show you what the result would look like in this machine here. So to start, I'm going to go down and click on the connect link. And this is going to open an RDP file that will allow me to RDP into that machine. So you can see this is a server 2012 image, and there's a few things here on the desktop that I will get into, but let me just jump right into the developer experience here. If I'm a developer, I've got Visual Studio 2013 installed, I've opened this up, all the development tools and templates that I need to build all kinds of applications. It can be just a simple desktop application, it can be a Windows app. I've got the Windows Azure SDK installed, so I can build a cloud services app if I prefer. Web is here, so to build my ASP.NET web application, if I'm going to deploy an application to, say, a web farm running in virtual machines in Azure, I have everything I need to build those applications. I think go now to the desktop. Just want to show you some of the tools that are installed. And I'm just doing a quick search on the desktop for SQL. This does have, you know, not just the SQL Server database engine, but it's got all the tools that you would expect. So we have the SQL Server Management Studio. We got the Configuration Manager. There's the Profiler. So if you want to need to do some SQL query profiles, you'll be able to do that as well. So everything that you would need from a SQL Server development perspective, as well as managing that instance, is already available and ready to go. I'm going to go ahead and open up SQL Server Management Studio just to show you. This is all set up and ready to go. We got, I'm going to go ahead and connect locally to that instance. And here you can see, obviously, it's just got the system databases set up for right now, but it is an active instance of SQL Server ready to be developed against. All right, so let's go to the desktop again. What I want to point out here is, I guess, first of all, in this folder right here, this Configure Developer Desktop folder, if you open this up, you'll find a few folders in here for tools, software, and scripts. And one I want to point out is the scripts folder. So on this particular instance, the way that I got the SQL Server set up and running was I simply just opened this folder up, right-clicked on the Configure SQL Server, and said Run with PowerShell. And it actually will go and set up that SQL Server instance on this machine. It literally is just right-click and run, and you'll be set up and ready to go. It does take a few minutes, obviously, but once that was done, all I had to do was just open up SQL Server Management Studio and log in and start to create my databases. Now, I can do the same thing with the SharePoint environment as well. So you get two options here. You can configure a SharePoint farm, or you can configure a SharePoint farm in a domain. So again, just right-click on those and run those scripts, and that will set up your environment for you. There's also some help pages on the desktop here. So for example, here's one to configure SharePoint standalone. So if you just click on this, it actually walks you through step-by-step everything that you need to do to configure this environment. And of course, they start at the very beginning of, you know, creating the virtual machine from the Windows Azure portal, which is the step I just walked through. So it gives you that information as well. But then once you've got your machine set up, it gives you the steps that you need to finish provisioning that environment, which is essentially what that script does in the scripts folder. Same thing for SharePoint in an Active Directory environment, as well as configuring SQL Server. You have your tools that you would expect, so things like your SharePoint Management Shell and SharePoint Central Administration tool is available there as well. So that's how you can use the Windows Azure Gallery to create a developer machine in Windows Azure. So while the Windows Azure Management Portal is certainly easy to use, to really automate the process of provisioning virtual machines and creating sandbox environments, you're going to typically want to script the process through PowerShell. Everything you can do from the portal, you can do from PowerShell. And in fact, you can do more with PowerShell if you prefer. If you're not comfortable writing your own scripts from scratch, there are some handy little scripts specifically for dev tests that you can grab that are out on GitHub. So I'm just highlighting where this repository is on GitHub, but in here you're going to find scripts to, for example, create an AD forest, or a script to create a SharePoint developer machine, whether that machine be joined to a domain or not. You'll also see some of the common application environments. So for example, a web development machine that's got IIS, ASP.NET configured with SQL Server. And there's some networking scripts and so on. So be sure to check that out, whether you're looking for a script to start from or maybe just a reference point for building your own scripts. So I wanted to take a minute and show you now a demo of simply just creating a new development environment using PowerShell. In this demo, I'm going to show you how to achieve essentially the same thing that I showed previously, which is creating a development machine using the Visual Studio 2013 image from the gallery. But this time I'm going to start strictly from PowerShell. I'm going to use a script that's in the Script Center, specifically for provisioning a machine from the Visual Studio 2013 gallery image. It's the same image. It has Visual Studio 2013 installed on it. It's got SQL Server 2012 Developer Edition, as well as the SharePoint 2013 tools that I had shown previously. When you download this zip file, you're going to find inside there's going to be a few different scripts that you can run, and they're highlighted down here. The one I'm going to show is this one right here, creating a web SQL development machine. But there's other ones for creating a SharePoint developer machine. There's also one for creating a virtual network. If you need to create a new Active Directory forest, you can do that as well. So there's a few scripts that come in that zip file when you download that. So I have already downloaded this, and I have the script to create a web SQL developer machine open in my PowerShell ISE. To run this script, you essentially just need to feed it the parameters that it needs in order to reach out to Windows Azure and start provisioning the virtual machine. So you can see there's quite a few parameters there. So I'm just going to walk you through each of these. Down here in the prompt window, you can see I've got here, I'm actually calling the script, and I'm passing in the first parameter is the image name. So this is the actual name of the image in the gallery for Visual Studio 2013. And it's kind of a long and cryptic name, but that's the actual name of the image. There's a separate image name for professional as well. So if your subscription level is professional instead of ultimate, then you obviously can use that. Or if you just want to use the professional image for your testing, you could do that. The next one is the Azure published settings file. So this is just pointing to the published settings file that I downloaded for my subscription. The next one is the name of the subscription. So this is my subscription name, as well as the storage account that I want the image and the underlying VHD for the virtual machine to be stored in. The name of the virtual machine is going to be PPE Dev03. I'm going to stick with the recommended size of large for this virtual machine. And I can also indicate whether or not I want it to be in a VNet. And so just like in the last demo, I provisioned the virtual machine in my demo VNet. I'll do the same here using PowerShell. And then the last two parameters are essentially just my credentials. So I can log into the machine once that machine's been provisioned. So I'm going to go ahead and start this. And here we can see it's starting to create the virtual machine, PPE Dev03. And this actually takes quite a while to complete, so I'm not going to go through the entire process. But we'll see. Let me pop back over to the portal real quick and see if we can start to see this thing being provisioned. And there you can see it's starting to provision PPE Dev03. Now, as you know, this is going to take 5 or 6 minutes. Point is you can start this provisioning process directly from PowerShell without having to go into the portal. Finally, you can also drop down to the underlying management APIs if you want the ultimate control for provisioning your environments. These are REST APIs that you can use to go beyond what the Windows Azure Management Portal and PowerShell offer. Now, this obviously requires developer skills to take advantage of, but the option is there if you need it. Now that you've seen how you can create these sandbox environments in Azure, let's take a look at how you can connect to these environments from your on-premise environment or remotely. This slide depicts a typical on-premises environment with a hypothetical sandboxed environment running in Azure. And this environment has a couple of web servers. It's got application servers, SQL servers. It even has a domain controller deployed to it. So this is your typical three-tier web application. Suppose that you want to do some development or testing on this application. A nice hybrid connectivity feature of Windows Azure, which is particularly useful for dev test, is this ability to connect to your environment running in Azure through a point-to-site VPN connection, rather than, say, through a public IP address for PowerShell or RDP. And in fact, if you recall from the earlier networking module in this course, when you deploy your virtual machines in a virtual network, you can also remove all the public endpoints and just connect to your resources through a secure VPN connection. In this scenario, remote workers can use a point-to-site VPN to connect to these machines. On-premises users could do the same. So for dev test scenarios, this point-to-site connectivity is super useful as you create and destroy these sandboxed environments. essentially the way it works is you would generate a certificate for the environment in Azure and then install that certificate on each client machine that needs to connect to it. And this gives you the control that you need over who can connect to the machines running in the virtual network. As users need to connect to the environment, they can simply just use their standard Windows VPN client to discover and connect to the virtual network running in Azure, and then ultimately the virtual machines in that virtual network using, say, an RDP connection. There's no special software that's needed to be installed. They can just use Windows Azure VPN client to make the connection. So let's take a look now at using point-to-site networking to connect to virtual machines running in a virtual network in Azure. In this demo, I'm going to demonstrate connecting to a Windows Azure virtual machine using a point-to-site VPN connection. The machine I'm going to connect to is this PPE2014 client machine that you can see in the virtual network here. Before I get started on that, I want to show you on this machine real quickly. Just go check out the endpoints on this. And I want to point out here that I've deleted all the endpoints, public endpoints that you typically get with a virtual machine. So for example, this PPE DirSync machine, it has the PowerShell and remote desktop endpoints. I have deleted those from this machine. And I've done that intentionally because I want to just point out that you don't need these public endpoints when you have point-to-site VPN connectivity. Now, to connect to this machine or any of these machines in the virtual network for that matter, using a point-to-site VPN connection, there is some setup work that you have to do. And I've done most of this already, so let me just explain the steps that I took. So on my local machine, I first created a self-signed certificate authority using the Make Cert tool. And from that CA certificate, I created a client certificate. Now, this client certificate is installed on my local machine, obviously, since I created them here. But if I wanted to, I could install this certificate on another client machine or give others in my organization this certificate so that they can connect to the machines in this virtual network as well. It's through this certificate that you can control access to the virtual network. The next thing I did was I exported the root certificate from the certificate store in my machine, and I uploaded that certificate to the certificates page for my virtual network. So that's what you see right here, that PPE2014 root CA. That's that root certificate that I created on my machine. So once all that's been set up and my gateway's been created, I'm almost ready to connect to these virtual machines. I wanted to point out something here. Of the three machines, let's just focus on the PPE2014 client machine. This machine is in the client subnet, and it has an IP address of 10.0.1.5. And so what I'll be able to do is connect to this virtual machine using that IP address through this point-to-site VPN connection. The next thing you need to do is you need to download the client VPN package. And that's available in a 32-bit and 64-bit form. And you just click these links right here, and that will download the package to your machine. I've already got this downloaded, but I'm just showing you a couple of things. One, how to download it, and two, I just wanted to point out this long cryptic name for the executable actually matches this virtual network ID for the virtual network. So that's kind of one way you can identify these client VPN packages if you are doing this for multiple virtual networks. And like I said, I've already got this downloaded, so I'm not going to download it again, but I just wanted to point that out. So I'm going to go over to the folder where I have that downloaded, and I'm just going to run this. And it's going to ask me, do you want to install the client for PPE VNet? I'm going to say yes. You'll see a little console window pop up just briefly. And now the VPN client package is on my machine. Now that that VPN client package is on my machine, I can go and discover that network and connect to it just like I would any other network using my Windows network utility. So I'm just going to go over here to my network, and you can see now I have PPE VNet available as a possible network connection. So I'm going to click the connect button, and it's going to give me a little prompt here to say, are you sure you want to connect? I'm going to say yes, and now we're connected. If I go back in there, we should see, yes, it is connected. So the last thing I want to point out is this IP address again. Just remember it's 10.0.1.5. If I want to connect to that, I can just use traditional RDP. So I'm going to use 10.0.1.5. I'm going to connect. I'm going to enter the credentials for this machine, accept the certificate, and I'm off and running now. So I am now connected to that client machine running in my virtual network. And I did this through the point-to-site VPN connection, did not go through a public RDP endpoint. So that's how you can set up and use point-to-site VPN connectivity to connect to your environments in the cloud. In this next demo, I want to talk about copying virtual machines across subscriptions. So we've been seeing different ways of creating these sandboxed environments. But another very powerful feature of the Windows Azure platform, and something that aligns well with dev test, is taking an environment from one subscription and replicating it in another. In this demonstration, I'm going to introduce you to a PowerShell script that you can use to copy virtual machines from one Azure subscription to another. In particular, I'm going to copy this Rickrain Dev1 virtual machine that's actually running right now from this subscription that's linked to my Hotmail account to another subscription. The script I'm going to show you is in the Opsgility account on GitHub, and it's the Azure VM Copy repository. It's just this one file. You can download this file yourself and test it out or expand on it if you'd like. But it's a PowerShell script that will copy your existing virtual machine configuration as well as any data desk associated with your virtual machine to a target subscription. Before I start this, I want to show you the target subscription that we're going to be copying the virtual machine to. So this is my target subscription, and you can see this one I'm logged in using my organizational ID at rick@opsgility.com. And there's several virtual machines in here. There's not one for Rickrain Dev1. These are my storage accounts. I have three. I'm going to be copying the VHD for the source virtual machine to this Opsgility Labs storage account. So while we're not going to actually wait for the virtual machine to copy over to the target subscription, we will be able to at least see the VHD copied to the storage account. So I've got a copy of the Azure VM Copy PowerShell script in my PowerShell ISE. And down here in the prompt window, I've got it set up, so all I got to do is press enter to go, but I'll walk you through the parameters. First of all, you need to give it a source subscription. So my source subscription is this MSDN subscription. It's linked to my Microsoft account. The destination subscription is this Opsgility BizSpark subscription, which is linked to my organizational account. The virtual machine that I want to copy is Rickrain Dev1. The service name that it's running in is also Rickrain Dev1. And I'm going to give this a new service name in the target subscription. I'm going to call it QA Dev1. So, for example, maybe I'm creating a QA environment. And the destination storage account will be Opsgility Labs, and the location will be West US. So I'm going to go ahead and kick this off. And the first thing you'll see is it's going to back up the VHD to a local storage account. Since this machine is running, it's going to make that local copy first, and then it's going to proceed to copy the VHD to the target subscription. What you're seeing here is basically just a polling where every 30 seconds, this is going to update the status. So in just a few seconds here, we'll see the bytes copied go from zero to some other number. So we'll give that just a second to, actually, while that's running, there it goes. So you can see that this is running. It's going to take a while, obviously, going from one subscription to the next. But what we can do is go take a look at the target storage account and see the VHD file being copied to the container there. I'm going to switch over to the target storage account, which is this one here with my organizational ID. And I'm going to drill into Hostility Labs. And we'll go to containers, VHDs. And there is the VHD that's being copied to the target subscription. Now, when this script completes, I will see in the virtual machines, I will also see Rick Rain Dev 1 over here. It's going to take a while, so we won't wait for that. But this script will facilitate copying your virtual machines from one subscription to another. So we've seen how you can leverage Azure to support your dev test workloads to spin up and tear down these environments as needed. I want to transition now at the end here to some strategies that you can apply to help control your cost for these environments. So what are some of the ways to control costs associated with these environments? You could simply mandate that everyone be responsible for shutting down their virtual machines when they are not using them. This, though, can be time-consuming. It can be a manual process that has to be performed day to day. And the reality of this happening is just not very likely. Now, you could ease the pain a little and provide some scripts that perform the shutdown on all the machines. So this is a little bit more automated in that at least you've wrapped up the individual steps for each machine into a script, but you're still at the mercy of the developer or the tester to remember to run the script. And you also have the possibility that there may have been some new virtual machines provisioned that are not handled by the script. But still, it's better than nothing. Now, a really powerful feature in Windows Azure is this auto-scale feature, whereby you can start and stop your virtual machines on a schedule. You can also do this with PowerShell, and you can even configure auto-scale through the APIs for a completely hands-off approach if you wanted to do that. The point is that you should try and take advantage of the elastic nature of the cloud as much as possible. And there are some really easy features in the platform to help you do this. So let's go through the auto scale feature. This feature enables you to scale your instances on a schedule. And this is really useful in the dev test workloads that we've been talking about today. Now you can, just to be clear, you can also auto scale using other metrics, but it's the auto scaling on a schedule that is perfect for dev test. Consider, for example, a web server farm that has 3 to 4 virtual machines. Through the cloud service settings, you could go into the scale page of the portal and set up schedules for days, nights, weekdays, and weekends. And you can specify the time when your day starts, you can specify the time when your day ends, and then you can let AutoScale start and stop your virtual machines based on that schedule. On this screen capture, I've indicated at the top that I want different scale settings for day and night, as well as for weekdays and weekends. Something else to note is the specific dates section at the bottom. And as an example of where you might use this, suppose there's a special event that you want to configure scale settings for that does not align to your normal schedule. You would be able to configure those times in this section of the portal. With the settings from the previous screen in place, I can now define my auto scale settings as needed. On this screen, I'm just simply telling Azure to give me 2 instances of my virtual machines during weekdays. The graph in the middle is showing how auto scale has been scaling my instances up and down. And you can see here that January 25th through the 26th was a weekend, and so my instances were auto scaled to 0. Then on Monday morning, the 2 instances were scaled back up for the duration of the day and then shut down in the evening. And this rotation continued throughout the week. On this screen, it looks almost identical. The difference being this time is that I'm defining the auto scale settings for weeknights to scale my instances down to 0. And last is the weekend schedule. Again, just indicating that I want to scale these instances down to 0 over the weekend. Now, I could have also kept just a portion of my instances running if I wanted to support the occasional weekend worker, for example. In that case, maybe I would have set this to 1, but you get the idea. So auto scaling by schedule is a really powerful feature for dev test workloads. So be sure to check this out when you're setting up your environments. In this demo, I'm going to show you where in the portal you can configure autoscale from. Then I'm going to switch over to PowerShell and show you how you can achieve basically the same thing using PowerShell. In this demo, I'm going to show you where you can configure autoscale for your services, and in particular, how you can set up autoscale for your virtual machines based on a schedule. And then I'm going to switch quickly over to PowerShell and show you how you can achieve the same thing using PowerShell commandlets. So what I've got here, I have one cloud service. It's called RickRain Dev1. And in this cloud service are three instances of virtual machines. Now I have two of them are running right now, and that's because of how I have autoscale currently configured. To set the autoscale settings, just go to the scale tab for your cloud service. And in here is where you'll see the settings that I was highlighting in the presentation. So for example, I have my weekday setting set to have two instances of my virtual machines running. If I want to go and change the weeknight settings, which are currently set to 0, if I wanted to change that to say 1, then I could do that. Or if I want to go change my weekend settings, you know, maybe I want to make that 1 as well over the weekend, I could do that as well. Once you save those settings, autoscale will then start scaling the service based on the new schedule. I'm going to go ahead and discard these changes for now, but that's where you would set up autoscale by schedule. So the next thing I want to show is how you can accomplish essentially the same thing using PowerShell. And there's a couple of scripts I'm going to introduce you to do that. But before I do, I want to introduce you to a couple of Azure PowerShell commandlets for starting and stopping virtual machines. These commandlets are particularly useful when your virtual machines and your cloud service are set up such that you followed a particular naming convention. So, for example, if you look at the three virtual machines in this cloud service, they all have the same name. The only difference is they have the number 1, 2, or 3 at the end of those. So this is going to allow me to apply some wildcard settings to these PowerShell commandlets I'm going to show you for starting and stopping the virtual machines. So I'm going to go over to the PowerShell ISE. And the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to get the status for the VMs right now, just so you can see. So there's my three virtual machines, RickRain Dev 1, 2, and 3. And these are running in the service RickRain Dev 1. Two of these virtual machines are in the ready state, or they're running, and the other one is stopped. So one of the things you can do is through the stop Azure VM commandlet, you can actually pass in wildcards to stop the virtual machine. So for example, instead of specifically stopping RickRain Dev 1 and then specifically stopping RickRain Dev 2, I can just use wildcard patterns to say stop everything in that service. So that would look something like this. So I'm basically saying stop all virtual machines that start with RickRain Dev in the name for the service name, RickRain Dev 1. And since I'm stopping, I need to also give it the force switch. So this will take just a minute or two, but let me pop back over to the portal and you can see, okay, so it's actually already stopped these virtual machines. Oh, there we go. So here you can see the actual operation succeeded. So that's one way that you can stop the virtual machines. You can also do the same thing with starting. So there is a start Azure VM. And you can do the same, apply the same wildcard syntax to this. This one does not need force on it. So now what I'm doing is telling Azure to go start all the virtual machines in the RickRain Dev 1 service. So all three of these machines are now going to get started. I'm going to switch over to the portal real quick. And what we should see here in just a second is these machines starting up. And there they are. So you can see now that all three machines are starting. It still hasn't returned back, but it'll come back in just a minute and give me essentially an operation ID and some kind of status. It's going to say it's succeeded. So this is really useful, especially when you have several machines in your cloud service that you need to start and stop. Imagine how useful this can be if you had, say, 10 machines in the cloud service that you wanted to start and stop. You know, being able to apply that wildcard syntax is particularly useful. So the next thing I want to show you is a couple of scripts that are in the script center that allow you to do the same thing I just showed you, but do it on a schedule. So there's one called Start Windows Azure Virtual Machines on a Schedule, and then another one for Stop Windows Azure Virtual Machines on a Schedule. And this is the Start script. And just to give you an idea of what this would look like, here you can, you know, you pass in the service name and then the wildcard syntax for your virtual machines in that service. And you can say when you want to start those virtual machines. And there's some other parameters you can pass in as well, but this is, you know, gives you an idea of what you can do with it. Likewise, there's a stop script. Again, passing in the name of the service, the wildcard syntax for your virtual machines in that service, and then a time of when you actually want to stop those virtual machines. It's particularly useful to be able to do this from PowerShell. You can also do it from the portal, as I showed earlier. Just grab these scripts, and if you want to customize these scripts a little bit more to your liking, obviously you just download those and modify them to suit your needs. In this module, we looked at how Windows Azure can be used to run dev test workloads in the cloud. We talked about the challenges from the perspective of application owners and IT administrators, and how the Windows Azure platform, combined with MSDN dev test subscriptions and Visual Studio, deliver a solution that is favorable from both perspectives. We talked about the economics of this and some strategies for controlling the costs associated with dev test workloads. And finally, we saw some demos of various ways that you can get started, whether it be starting from the Windows Azure Management Portal or automating through PowerShell. These are some suggested learning exercises that augment the learning experience from this module. There's a couple of hands-on labs that'll walk you through creating virtual machines from the gallery, in this case, a Linux machine. We also have a lab to go through the starting and stopping of virtual machines on a schedule. And there's also some couple hours worth of videos that are handpicked for this session. So be sure to check that out and see how you can further explore the dev test workload scenario in Azure. Here are a couple of additional resources that you might want to explore. And then finally is our list of Windows Azure resources that we also recommend you check out. Here you're going to find lots of good content. And of course, as usual, if you have any questions, you can always check out Stack Overflow and the Windows Azure forums for community support. Coming up next is SQL Server and SharePoint, so be sure to stay tuned for that module. And that concludes our session. Thank you very much for your time.